This is it. This is one of the common entities, disease entities in neurology. Seizures and epilepsy. And I will be talking about what is the difference between the two of them. So for now, I will be discussing the definition and epidemiology of seizures. How do we classify seizures? What are the different causes? And what are the pathologic changes that take place when somebody is having a seizure? And very importantly is when a patient or when somebody is having seizures, what do we do to the patient? So this is the scope of the lecture. And the order of the lecture is based on the presentation in Harrison's Principles of Internal Medicine. However, I have other subspecialty sources of seizures and epilepsy. So class, I'm not sure if I already presented this case to you, but this is one of my patients. So at age 55, the patient was admitted due to involuntary tonic and clonic movements of the right arm and right leg. Okay. So eventually I concluded that these involuntary movements were indeed seizures. So the seizure attack was initially on one area of the body, the right side. So I labeled it as focal seizures at the start. So it was a focal onset seizure on the right side. But eventually the focal seizure became generalized because eventually it involved all the extremities already with subsequent loss of consciousness. That's LOC, loss of consciousness. And this patient, 1 year prior to this attack of seizures, was diagnosed to have stroke involving the right arm and the right leg. And months after his admission under me, I noted him to have residual weakness, a little weakness on the right arm and the right leg. But the patient was able to walk then and able to use also his right arm, although there was a little bit of weakness on both the right arm and the right leg. So after this attack of seizures, the patient was immediately brought to the emergency room. And when I saw him in the hospital emergency room, he was already awake. After the loss of consciousness, he was already awake. However, he was confused. He did not know where he was. And he was a little restless. And I noted the motor function of the right arm and the right leg to be. So this is on the right side only, class. The motor function was 3/5 over both upper, over right, both right upper and lower extremities. The patient had Babinski sign on the right side. So class, if you notice, after the stroke, the motor function of the patient was 4/5. But now after the seizure, it is 3/5. So this is the definition of seizures. It is a paroxysmal event, meaning it would occur suddenly. Ami, pakimute tragodning saba, Ami.
Okay, but...
Okay. So it would occur suddenly with... seizure is a paroxysmal event. And the reason for developing seizures is due to an abnormal, excessive, hypersynchronous discharge from a part of the brain. So seizures are always produced by the brain. So it is always the cerebral cortex that is irritated when somebody is having a seizures. So definitely the problem is in the central nervous system. So as far as history of seizures is concerned in the olden times, most people would label seizures as the act of somebody supernatural. As a matter of fact, the term epilepsy is coined from the Greek word to be seized from outside or from without. However, even early on, the father of medicine already labeled seizures as something that is an organic disease of the brain. So, okay, I'm going to skip this, but there are plenty of celebrities that were noted to have seizures, but even with their seizures, they were still able to do many things. Okay? So anyway, how do we know that somebody is having a seizure attack? Class, if any of you have seen patients having seizures, maybe the most common manifestation that you saw was an involuntary movement of any part of the extremities, of any of the extremities. So these involuntary movements are, of course, involuntary, outside of the will of the patient. So that is the usual manifestation of seizures, motor convulsions. However, seizure attacks also have atypical descriptions. So in addition to the usual motor seizures, there are also seizure attacks with atypical presentation. Like for example, some patients may just manifest with just a brief lack of awareness or the patient not paying any attention to what is happening around. Okay, so it can already be a manifestation of seizures. As what I was saying, this is one of the most common disease entities in neurology. Because among the whole population, all of us, approximately 5 to 10% of us at any point in our lives may develop seizures. So these seizures may be a single attack only, or some of us may have the first seizure now and eventually will have another attack, okay, or recurrent attacks. So class, take note, that's 5 to 10% of the general population. And it is noted that the chances of having seizures is highest during the early childhood and late adulthood. As a matter of fact, half of the first onset seizures happen during childhood and adolescence. However, it is the babies who have the highest risk of developing seizures. And the problem with babies is that they cannot express themselves. So that's why this is the most high-risk group.
Doc? Po yung mic niyo po, Doc. Doc, nawala po ang munti niyo, Doc.
Done, Doc.
Okay, thank you. This one also. So
Yes,
I think
Doc.
it just here, right? This one, epilepsy.
Doc, I think it was a previous slide.
Okay, this one, or this one. Okay. So did you see this? Finished. Yes.
Done, Doc.
Okay. Okay, thank you. So anyway, as what I was saying, if a seizure attack becomes recurrent and there is no trigger for it, so meaning it is not a provoked attack and yet it keeps on recurring at least twice, so we label this already as epilepsy. So some of our patients who start to have seizures eventually become epileptics or turn out to have recurrent attacks. So even if there is only one attack, we have to carefully consider or analyze, why is the patient having seizures? What is irritating? Why is the brain of this patient irritated? So we have to really analyze. So anyway, going to the term epilepsy class, it is two or more episodes of unprovoked seizures. So when I say unprovoked, it is not provoked by any physiologic changes, because there are seizures that occur because the patient is under a certain stressful condition. For example, if any of you would not be able to sleep for 3 days because you are studying for long examination and you really want to study much and you do not sleep. So, okay, if you do not sleep at all for 2 or 3 days and then the next morning you also fail to eat your breakfast and you fail to eat lunch, Then by afternoon, some of you may already be having seizure attacks. However, this is a provoked attack because your body is under a certain amount of stress. Okay, so you are sleepless and you are also hungry. Okay, these are some of the provoking factors as far as seizures are concerned. Or when some of you do not or fail to sleep and you also drink much alcohol and you also forget to eat your dinner, then this combination of factors also are triggers to seizure attack. But these are provoked seizures. On the other hand, epilepsy is two or more seizure attacks that are not provoked at all. Okay? So, the seizures here are recurrent. And usually, when a patient has recurrent seizures, there is really something abnormal underlying in the brain. Okay, so the incidence of recurrent seizures or epilepsy is 3 to 5 per 1,000 people. So these are the new cases. And the old and new cases is now 5 to 10 per 1,000 people. So that's incidence and prevalence. So class, this is a summary of how often we encounter patients with seizures. Okay, can you hear me, class? Can you still hear me?
Yes, doc.
Okay, thank you. So I mentioned in the introduction that 5 to 10% of the general population tend to have seizures that are either single attack only or multiple attacks. But we will use the value 9%. So 9% of the population may have seizures at any time of our lives. And we divide this into non-epileptic and epileptic seizures. Meaning, epileptic seizures are recurrent seizures, two or more attacks. While non-epileptic seizures are single attacks only. So approximately one third of people with seizures have recurrent attacks. And two thirds of people with seizures only have single attacks, not repeated anymore. Okay? So for those with single attacks only, so that's two thirds, 6% out of 9%. So those who are non-epileptic are divided into physiologic attacks. Okay, so that's 5 out of 6. What do we mean by physiologic attack? I think those are the situations that I mentioned. Any alteration or disturbance in the physiology of our body can potentially lead to seizures. Okay, like hunger, lack of sugar, lack of sleep, extreme fatigue. Okay, exposure to extreme heat or extreme cold. Okay, so these are examples of physiologic disturbances or intake of alcohol and other triggering substances. So these are situations that lead to disturbance in our physiology. So that's why these are physiologic seizures. And these seizures may not recur at all if we correct the disturbance in our physiology. Whereas 1 out of 6 of single attack seizures are psychogenic. So meaning, these are not true seizures. So these are seizures that are usually manufactured either consciously or unconsciously by the patient. So that's 1 out of 6. So there is some psychiatric side to it also. Now let us go to the other side. To the seizures that are recurrent. These are the epileptic seizures. That's 3 out of 9 or one third. Epileptic seizures are divided into two. Two thirds are related to something that is abnormal in a certain part of the brain. We call this localization related seizures. Example, if a patient has a tumor in the right frontal area or a stroke in the left frontal area, or an encephalitis in the left parietal area. These are these are lesions that are confined to certain locations. And these are lesions or diseases that can potentially produce seizures because they are irritating the brain. So these are examples of localization-related seizures. Now, 1/3 or 1 out of 3 of recurrent or epileptic seizures are generalized seizures. They are generalized seizures, and sometimes we do not know where they are coming from, but still the same, the patient is having seizures, and these are recurrent. So when do we treat? We treat when seizures have a chance of becoming recurrent. Okay, so usually we treat patients who we label as having epileptic seizures. Okay, so according to the International League Against Epilepsy, seizure types are of 3 types. We have focal onset seizures. So starting from one part of the body only. And we have generalized onset seizures. So these are starting simultaneously from the right side as well as the left side of the brain. And these generalized seizures are further divided into certain types. Like we have the generalized tonic-clonic seizures. We call this the grand mal seizures. And we have the absent seizures. We call this the petit mal due to lack of movement of the extremities. Only the eyes are noted to be blinking and staring blankly into space alternately. Okay. Plus, we have the typical and atypical generalized seizures, clonic only or tonic only, or atonic seizures. In atonic seizures, there are no observable movements. And the third classification of seizures are the seizures that are not very clear at all. We do not know if it's focal or generalized, because usually the witness to the seizure would see the patient only towards the latter part of the seizure. So that's why the onset, the seizure type at onset is not very clear. Okay, so this is how the International League Against Epilepsy classifies or had classified seizure attacks. And now, epilepsy. These are the recurrent seizures. There is a separate classification for epilepsy. There are also 3. Number 1 is localization related, or these are the focal seizures. And these are brought about by something that is abnormal in the brain. Number 2 are idiopathic seizures. These are usually generalized, and we do not know what is causing the attack. However, these are symptomatic seizures, and usually we end up treating them or starting the patient on anticonvulsant. And the 3rd classification of epilepsies are the different syndromes of and generalized epilepsies. So we have idiopathic epilepsies, benign febrile convulsions. Okay, so these are seizures that are noted when the child is febrile. We have absent seizures, and we have juvenile myoclonic epilepsy and the other syndromes, plus symptomatic and secondarily generalized seizures, which are found mainly in the pediatric population, the West syndrome and Lennox-Gastaut syndrome. Okay, so these are examples of epilepsy types. So to explain a little on the description of these different types of seizures, we have 2 types of focal seizures. When we speak of the 1st classification of epilepsy, we have the localization-related epilepsy or focal seizures. There are 2 types. One is focal seizures not associated with any alteration in consciousness. We call them focal seizures without these cognitive features, wherein the patient is having focal seizures but the consciousness is fully intact during the attack. The 2nd type of focal seizures is or are focal seizures with these cognitive features, meaning the patient is having focal seizures, and prior to that or during the seizure attack, the consciousness of the patient is also altered or impaired. And usually it is in this type of seizure that some of the patients may report what we call premonitory signs, which we call aura, okay, or behavioral arrest. For example, some of the patients immediately prior to an attack may report that they are able to smell something that we do not see to be around the patient. Or the patient may report that he is hearing something that is not actually there. Okay, these are examples of aura. And some patients manifest with automatisms, or these are involuntary automatic behaviors like to and fro opening of the hands, or to and fro transferring of the hands from one point to another. Okay, so these are automatisms that may accompany focal seizures with these cognitive features. Okay, class, are you still there? Can you hear me? Do you have any questions so far? Oh, okay, so please just feel free to ask if you have any clarification so I can address them right away. Anyway, so a focal seizure is defined as a seizure activity that is restricted or coming from a focal area or a discrete area of the cerebral cortex. Because as what I was saying, seizures are always coming from the cerebral cortex. So when the cerebral cortex is irritated, either by an actual disease like stroke or tumor, or by a certain disturbance in the physiology, seizures are produced from the cerebral cortex. Now, focal seizures are usually associated with a structural abnormality of the brain. And if we are not sure if seizures start focally or not focally, we just need to check if any of these three features are present. Okay, so this description are coming from Harrison's class. You can read about this in Harrison's. But anyway, the three features that suggest that seizures are focal include Jacksonian march. Okay, so this is gradual progression of focal movement from one extremity. Then after a few seconds, two extremities are already moving involuntarily. Then after a few seconds, three extremities are moving. And afterwards, towards the end, all the four extremities are moving. So there is progression of extremity involvement. We call this Jacksonian march. TADS paralysis is the occurrence of transient weakness or focal neurologic deficit in the area of the body that is involved in the seizure. So this is a temporary weakness or focal deficit. And the usual time for this to disappear or resolve is 24 hours more or less after the seizure. So this is just a transient paralysis. The problem is that if we do not know if the patient is just having TADS paralysis or a stroke. So in patients who present with TADS paralysis, sometimes we end up working them up so we would be able to rule out a stroke. Okay, and the third one is epilepsia partialis continua. This is continuous movement of certain or some of the extremities. Okay, but focally only, never generalizing. And this will go on for a certain number of minutes or even hours. Okay, so if any of these three features or descriptions are present in the patient, then most probably the seizures are focal in onset. So I am supposed to show to you a video of focal onset seizures, but this is not playing. So I will just be sending the video to the class president. So this is, okay, this is supposed to be focal onset seizures without, that was without these cognitive features. And this one is focal onset seizures with these cognitive features. I will just be sending the video to the class president for sharing to others. And okay, this one has no video, but generalized seizures has a video here. And it is generalized because they start simultaneously from both cerebral hemispheres. So I will send this video also. So anyway, another type of generalized seizures, which I mentioned already, is absence seizure. However, absence seizures are characterized not by thrashing tonic-clonic movements. What we are able to see in the child who has absence seizures is just involuntary repetitive blinking of the eyes and staring blankly into space without any observable movement of extremities. That's why we call this absence seizures or petit mal seizures. So the problem with this is that it is generalized. And when the child is having attacks, he becomes unconscious and he is unaware of what is happening in the environment. Usually these absent seizures happen in children. So that's why if they are in school, it is sometimes the teacher who notices that the child is absent-minded, and with times that the child is just staring blankly into space, and that the teacher would describe these children as absent-minded and not listening to my lesson. And this is going to be reflected in the poor outcome when it comes to grades. Okay, so these children, when they have repeated attacks, because these absent seizures tend to occur several times in one day, these children will eventually have poor grades in school because of failure to concentrate on the subject matter. So it usually happens at age 4 to 8 years or early adolescence. Now, if you are suspecting this, it is easy to document. You just subject the child to an EEG, electroencephalogram. And what we will see in the EEG is the typical finding compatible with absent seizures, which we call the 3 to 4 hertz spike and wave discharges. Okay, so this is really pathognomonic of absent seizures. And I will be sending this video again to the class president. There are also atypical absent seizures, and we have the common generalized tonic-clonic seizures. The usual cause for generalized tonic-clonic seizures is metabolic abnormality, like the accumulation of certain substances in the blood leading to a disturbance in the functioning of the brain. We also have what we call atonic seizures. In this type of seizures, we do not see any tonic-clonic movements. However, there is transient loss of postural muscle tone because of sudden attack of seizure in the brain. And this would last for a few seconds only. There is brief impairment of consciousness. And the problem with this type of seizure, the atonic seizures, is that there is no warning sign to the patient. So when the patient immediately has the attack, the patient will not be able to watch out. And the patient tends to just fall down. Okay, so these are the patients who sustain head injuries because without warning, the seizures occur resulting to falls and loss of balance. So anyway, how do we know that the patient is having atonic seizures? So early on, right after the attack of seizure, we should subject these patients to EEG again. And if we do it early, we may be able to see on EEG the generalized spike and wave discharges followed by slow waves. Okay, so this is what happens when one is having atonic seizures. Now we have another seizure type, which we call myoclonic seizures. And this is characterized by sudden and brief contraction of muscles. Okay, the patient involving one or more extremities will suddenly pull the extremity towards the center, and then it will immediately go back also to the actual area. So these are sudden and brief muscle contractions. Now, class, there are special epilepsy syndromes. I mentioned them already, juvenile myoclonic epilepsy and Lennox-Gastaut syndrome. This is a very bad syndrome for children because the children could turn out to have multiple seizure types. The EEG, when we do it, will show to us very slow 3 hertz spike and wave discharges. Plus, these patients end up having cognitive dysfunction. Plus, we have the syndrome, the Michel temporal lobe epilepsy syndrome. So these are, okay, these are seizures that occur in patients who during childhood has had recurrent febrile seizures. So these recurrent febrile seizures, if uncontrolled, will result to scarring of the involved temporal lobe. And with scarring and damage to the temporal lobe, these areas are now prone to the development of future seizures. Okay, class. So please study the comparison and summary of the different features of the different seizures. So we have the simple partial seizure here versus complex partial, the absence seizure, and the generalized tonic-clonic seizures. Okay, so usually they are partial and generalized tonic-clonic movements may manifest for 5 to 10 seconds or a few minutes only. Now, please take note that all the lower three types of seizures may have loss of consciousness afterwards. And in simple partial seizures, there's no loss of consciousness. What about post-ictal confusion? Patients with simple partial seizures and absence seizures are the ones that usually do not manifest with post-ictal confusion. And of course, when we do EEG early, for simple partial seizures, there may be focal spikes. For complex partial seizure, the focal activity may spread to involve one or both hemispheres. And for absence seizures, the appearance is generalized 3 to 4 weeks spike and wave discharges. Plus, we have the generalized tonic-clonic seizures occurring usually for 1 to 2 minutes. There may be loss of consciousness, and and then in generalized tonic-clonic seizures, there are a series of generalized high amplitude spikes. If you take a look at the EEG, class, do you have questions so far, class?
No.
Okay, thank you. So, class, according to your book, Harrison's, seizures are characterized by 3 observations. First and foremost, even if the brain is normal, if the brain is significantly provoked by circumstances, it may produce a seizure. Okay, so therefore, a normal brain is capable of having a seizure. Number 2, there are certain diseases that would result to extreme likelihood of seizure attacks, okay? Or will result to recurrent attacks. So these are conditions that predispose to seizure. Example is brain tumor or viral encephalitis, brain abscess. These are conditions with likelihood of resulting into a chronic seizure attack, which will become recurrent. And the third observation, of course, is that seizures are episodic. So meaning, now there is no attack, and later there is an attack. And then, afterwards, there is no more attack again, and later another attack may take place. Okay, so this is the meaning of episodic. And class, why do we develop seizures and epilepsy? It is because of an imbalance. There are two opposing factors in the brain that we have to balance. Okay? Excitatory postsynaptic potentials and inhibitory postsynaptic potentials. So any imbalance in these seizures may result to a seizure attack. So please take note when we review the physiology of a resting membrane. Okay, so when the cell, when the neuron is resting, we have extracellular, the extracellular cap, anion and cation. We have sodium and chloride. And intracellular potassium and organic acids. And we have now depolarization of the neuronal membranes. So the hallmark of an epileptic neuron is when we see evidence of membrane depolarization. So class, what happens when we apply a certain stimulus to on the patient. So application of stimulus, there is activation of receptors, influx of sodium, potassium, and calcium. And another worrisome arrhythmia is the presence of paroxysmal depolarization sheath. Okay. Plus, we have large hyperpolarization. Okay, so are there any questions, class?
No, no.
Okay, thank you, class. So, class, briefly, I would like to describe, as is depicted in this picture or in this slide, what happens when a neuron is about to develop seizures. So, the conditions that predispose to seizure causation are if there is increased excitatory postsynaptic potentials. Number two, if there is decreased inhibition of the postsynaptic potentials. And when there is an increase in the excitatory potentials and a decrease in an inhibitory potentials, these are situations that really trigger the production of a seizure attack. So when there is seizure attack due to increased EPSPs and decreased IPSPs, this is what we call epileptogenesis. And this is made possible by the formation of a very large action potential, which is the paroxysmal depolarization shift. So next, with the paroxysmal depolarization shift, we also need to potentiate the excitatory postsynaptic potentials and to decrease the inhibitory postsynaptic potentials. So in this situation, there is also inhibition of the potassium currents. But afterwards, as the brain and the neurons become tired, they attempt to stop producing seizures. So with recovery period, there is activation of the intrinsic inhibitory currents, activation of recurrent inhibitory connections. Okay. And increase in norepinephrine leading to adenosine increase plus clearance of potassium and decrease in calcium. Okay. So these are the events that take place when somebody is about to have a seizure. Now, what causes our seizures? So as what I mentioned, there are two groups of stimuli for seizures. So we have the factors that are coming from inside the brain and the factors that are coming from outside the brain. So please take a look at this picture, class. So from inside the brain, we have, okay, so we have here, for localization in those seizures, we have here, trauma to the brain parenchyma. We also have, okay, so there are also triggers that are due to something else, like the formation of an arteriovenous malformation that will alter the usual physiology and may predispose to the production of, okay, so it will predispose to the production of a seizure attack. So we generalize seizure precaution, we have to have, okay, so in focal seizures, we really have to explain or we really have to investigate where is it coming from in the brain. So anyway, other causes of partial seizures that are coming from inside the brain are tumors, strokes, abnormal blood vessels, and also certain bleeding. Okay, so these are another type of causes of seizures are what we call the seizures that are coming from outside of the brain. So this is the case of seizure secondary to hypoglycemia, seizure secondary to intake of alcohol, or seizures that are due to abnormalities in sodium and potassium. Okay. And the absence or the lowered levels of calcium and magnesium, for example. Some patients develop seizures when they imbibe certain certain substances that manage to disturb the functioning of the brain. For example, alcohol and drugs of abuse can most of the time trigger seizures. So class, please take a look at the table in Harrison's. For babies less than 1 month, these are the usual causes of, okay, these are, there are several causes of seizures according to age group. So in the less than 1 month year old, these are the common causes of seizures. In infants, children, enumerated as a first cause is febrile seizures. Plus, CNS infection may be common in this age, as well as developmental disorders and the others. In young adults, trauma or alcohol withdrawal, illicit drug use, or brain tumors may trigger or may okay, so in young adults, these are the usual etiologies or causes of seizures. If the patient is an older adult, meaning he is older than 35, cerebrovascular accident tops the list of, okay, the list of the different etiologies that cause seizure in older adults. This is closely followed by metabolic disorders. Okay. So this, there are certain medications, class, that might trigger a seizure attack. So we have to be very careful when we are or when we decide to give these medications to the patient. Because if the patient is already having seizures and you give something that lowers the seizure threshold, then it is going to predispose to the occurrence of seizures. Okay? So, certain antibiotics, anesthesias, anesthetic agents, and pain relievers like tramadol, which we commonly use, can trigger seizures. The use of immunomodulators and psychotropic drugs and contrast media on radiologic testing can also lower seizure threshold. Plus, of course, sedatives or hypnotics and certain antipsychotics, plus drugs of abuse like amphetamine and cocaine can trigger seizure attacks. And certain dietary supplements. Therefore, class, we have to be very careful when we use these drugs in patients who have history of seizure attacks. Class, are you still there? Do you have questions?
No.
Okay, class. So we are now towards the last part of our objective. I would like to discuss on what are we going to do when we see a patient who is having seizures. Okay, so first and foremost, class, don't panic. Don't panic when you see somebody having seizures. Okay, so we have first and foremost to position that somebody well. When somebody is having seizures and is about to fall to the ground or to the floor, we have to make sure that somebody catches that person and will position that person properly on the floor or on the bed or on a certain surface that will not produce any injury to the body of the patient. So that is the most important thing to do. And we position these patients not lying down flat, because if we let them lie down flat, the tendency is for them to aspirate their saliva and it may result to aspiration pneumonia. So remember, when a patient is having seizures, the swallowing stops and there is closure of the glottis. Okay, so with cessation, temporary cessation of swallowing, there is accumulation of saliva and secretions in the mouth. And eventually, this will go down to the, supposedly saliva should go down through the esophagus, but the problem is that there is closure of the glottis and instead, it is the airways that are now open. So the airways are now prone to aspiration. So we have to be very careful and we have to position the patient on his side. Okay, so that is the first thing that we have to do. When we see somebody who's having a seizure, do not attempt to stop the seizure by yourself, because if the seizure decides to continue, we cannot really stop it. What we can do is just to position the patient well. Do not manipulate the mouth or any part of the body while the patient is having seizures, because your manipulation will not stop the seizures. The seizures will stop only when it decides to stop. Please remember that. So anyway, when we have an adult patient who is having a seizure, please take note of this algorithm which we find in Harrison's. Very important to make a quick investigation of the history and the physical examination findings quickly. Okay, and we have to know, is this patient having seizures already in the past? Is this patient placed already on certain anti-seizure drugs? So, because the next investigation will be, okay, if this is a new type of seizure, you just follow on the left side, on the right side of this picture, what we should be doing as our investigation. But if the patient is a known epileptic and is known to be taking anticonvulsants, we also follow this arrow or pathway on the left side of the screen. Okay, so anyway, you can read more about this in your book, Harrison's Principles of Internal Medicine. So anyway, class, when we encounter a person or when we see a person who has sudden onset of involuntary movements, what do we do? First and foremost is that we should decide, are these or not? Okay, very important, because there are also involuntary movements that are not seizures. We call them movement disorders. These involuntary abnormal movements are coming from the basal ganglia. So we have to know how to distinguish seizures from these movement disorders coming from the basal ganglia. Okay? So our differentials or the movement disorders include tremors. Okay, so class, please take note. Tremors are not seizures. Tremors are basal ganglia involuntary movements. Chorea, dystonia, hemibalismus. Okay, so chorea is a dance-like involuntary movement. Dystonia is a twisting, is an involuntary twisting, slow writing movement of a certain part of the body. Hemibalismus is a sudden flinging of one or more extremities outside of the axis of the body and then suddenly bringing back the extremity to the center of the body. We call this hemibalismus. Atytosis are involuntary snake-like movements of the extremities. Okay, so class, these are the different movement disorders. We have to be familiar with how these movement disorders appear like, so we would be able to distinguish them from the usual seizure attack. Okay, so differential diagnosis to seizures, we can find this also in a table in your book. Please take note that at the top of the line, we have syncopal attacks and orthostatic hypotension, metabolic disturbances, even migraine can be a differential to seizures. And take note, we have movement disorders and sleep disorders and strokes and breath-holding spells in children, okay, plus night terrors and sleepwalking. These are differential diagnoses to seizures because there is a page there that focuses on how we distinguish between seizures and syncopal attacks. It's very important to distinguish between the two because they are managed or treated differently. Seizures are treated with anticonvulsants, while syncopal attack is treated by trying to find out what is causing the syncope. Because the problem with syncopal attacks is that there is temporary lack of blood supply to the brain. And usually the cause here is cardiac problem. So anyway, there is a table that differentiates or distinguishes between seizure attack and syncopal attack. So how do we distinguish between the two? So patients with seizures usually have normal neurologic exam, normal neuroimaging procedures, and normal EEG if we do it late after the seizure attack. So class, very important, the most important tool that we use in the analysis of a seizure patient is to get a good history. And we are able to get this not from the patient, but from the family member or companion in the house who sees the attack. So this is the best source of information here when we try to get the history. Okay, class, can you still hear me? Do you have questions at this point?
No.
Can you hear me? Okay, thank you, class. So, class, this is how an EEG looks like, electroencephalogram. Okay, the ones on the left side are considered to be normal, but look at the ones on the right side of the screen. These are examples of abnormal EEGs. Okay? So, in a patient with seizures, the best tool is still good history taking and thorough physical and neurologic examination, class. So, please don't forget that. And in the history, we pay particular attention to these different factors, okay? Like description of the event, how does the seizure or the involuntary movement look like, how long is the attack, what are the preliminary symptoms of the patient, is there presence of incontinence or biting of the tongue during the attack? Because the presence of biting or incontinence is really highly suggestive of a seizure attack. Are there stressors to the seizure like pregnancy and fatigue and any infection? So these are important parts of the history that we have to focus on. And we have to be very clear about our descriptions, class. And in our physical examination, very important to take note of the vital signs. And in patients with possible stroke-related seizures, we auscultate the carotid for the presence of any brui that might be thrown to the cerebral circulation. What is the character of the cardiac rhythm? What is the color of the skin? What is the motor activity during an active convulsion? And of course, the automatisms, like I mentioned, are as follows. Okay, swallowing, chewing, and lip smacking are descriptions of automatisms. And on neurologic exam, very important to find out if there are neurologic abnormalities or focal deficits. Okay, plus the presence of hyperreflexia and Babinski sign and abnormal mental status. Okay, so how should we investigate? How intensive should be our investigation? So in the usual patient, we would order for these tests in the list, but we have to really be very sure that if it is a woman of childbearing age, that the woman is not pregnant, because by then the diagnosis will change to eclampsia of pregnancy if the patient is having seizures already. Or we have to investigate what is the, okay. We have to screen for any, the presence of any prohibited drug in the blood of the patient. So for certain procedures, it will depend on what you are closely suspecting to be the etiology of the seizures. For example, if you are thinking of CNS infection, then lumbar puncture and CSF studies may be helpful. And cranial imaging may be abnormal in 3 to 41% of first onset seizures, or abnormal in 22% of first onset seizures with normal CT scan. Okay, so the electroencephalogram is an important procedure. And please take note that a normal EEG does not rule out a seizure attack, class. Okay, so even if the EEG is normal, if the description of the movement is highly suggestive of, okay, is highly suggestive of any attack, then we have to really document it. Plus, inpatient video EEG monitoring will be the best modality for us to be able to identify what is causing the involuntary movement in the patient. So next question, after having decided that this is really a seizure attack, the next question is that, is this the first time for the attack, or this is already a recurrent attack? And the next question is this a provoked attack? Because if provoked, this might just be what we call, due to disturbance in the physiology. But if it is unprovoked and it is recurrent, then we can label this already as epilepsy. And once we have decided that this might be epilepsy, we are duty bound to start anticonvulsant treatment. So class, I just would like to show you the different anti-epileptic drugs from the oldest to the youngest. So the oldest one is bromide, discovered in the 1860s. And as we went along, okay, phenobarbital was discovered after 1900 years. And as we go up and we go up along the line, these are the different anticonvulsants. So the higher they are in this chain, the more expensive they become. So class, the basic principle here is that we have to analyze what is the type of seizure that the patient has, and then we have to choose the right anticonvulsant depending on the character of the seizures of the patient. So our basis for anticonvulsant use is the efficacy of the drug, as well as minimal side effects or tolerability of our anticonvulsant. We have to balance these two factors. So class, this is found in a table in your book. And the ones in blue are the ones that are closely suggested to be given in patients with the seizure type, okay? So for primarily generalized seizures, our main our first line agents are valproic acid and lamotrigine. The rest are second line agents. For partial seizures, carbamazepine, phenytoin, valproic acid, and lamotrigine are the drugs of choice. Okay, so you can review about this in your book, Harrison's. Now, class, I would like to mention that when we are pushed against the wall, and even with several medications for treatment, the patient still continues to have a significant number of attacks of seizures, then we really have to decide, is this a triggered seizure? Okay, so if this is triggered, we have to, if the patient is already on several anticonvulsants, we have to entertain the possibility of epilepsy surgery. The principle behind epilepsy surgery, class, is that the neurosurgeon would try to ablate the pathway of the seizures. And if this pathway is already disturbed, then probably we can slow down the seizure attacks. Now, class, if somebody would tell you to make use of marijuana to control seizures, do not yet use it as of this time. The Philippine Neurological Association has yet not allowed the use of medical marijuana for seizure control because there are other better drugs for its management. So again, to summarize, how do we manage a patient who is having seizures? First and foremost, we start on anti-epileptic drugs, and please be guided by the drugs of choice. The next one is we can consider epilepsy surgery. And the third one is, that we should address the other problems of the patient so as to minimize the stress or the stress to the cerebral cortex. So anyway, class, I would like to introduce this term, status epilepticus. Okay, so this will happen if the patient is going to continue to have attacks. Attacks that do not stop for several minutes, or attacks that keep on recurring with the patient not waking up in between attacks. We call this status epilepticus. And by the World Health Association organization, this condition is characterized by an epileptic seizure that is sufficiently prolonged or repeated at sufficiently brief intervals so as to produce an underlying or enduring epileptic condition. Okay, so question is, what about seizures? Do we really need to stop them? So the question is, why do we need to stop seizures? So class, I would like to show you this diagram, class. This is the reason why we really have to stop seizures. Because what we can withstand is continuous attack for 30 minutes or less. Because with continuous attacks of less than 30 minutes, the brain of the patient can still, okay, can still take care of it. But after 30 minutes, certain parameters are already compromised. Okay, so look at this. After 30 minutes, the blood pressure now starts to go down. There is further increase in the levels of lactic acid, thereby resulting to acidosis, which is not good for the brain. Plus here, if we slow down in our picture of the, okay, of the picture of the patient, then we have to take note of the vital signs. After 30 minutes, the vital signs start to go down. Okay? So after some time, the seizures now merge, and this is the reason why our patients are unable to wake up and even become comatose. Okay? So it is because of electromechanical dissociation. So these are the systemic events taking place during status epilepticus, class. So one dictum that I would suggest that you remember is that time is brain. Okay, so time is brain. Every second that we waste in the management of our patients will, okay, result to the death of a certain number of neurons in the brain. Okay, so time is brain. And okay, class, if you have questions right now, you may ask your questions so I can address it. Do you have questions?
No, doc, we don't have any questions as of now.
Okay, so I'm not sure if you received already a copy of the headache and vertigo slides, but I will also be sending a copy of this one, of seizures and epilepsy. Okay, class, if there are no questions,